Good morning, everyone. What an awesome day we have today. An awesome day of worship, a new day. We have a new pastor here, as everybody knows. Stephen Smith, welcome. Welcome to the family. With Ken Kim. Kim, welcome to our family. The youth are back, and they had an exciting trip. Before we start worship, I want to say what you already know. God is so awesome. And some of that will be revealed as this morning goes on. I'd like to call your attention to in your seat. You have connect cards that have been passed out in your seat. There's pins in the back of every seat. Please fill, yes, Tim's holding one up. Please fill those out. I've been assured that we're not going to sell your name to any marketing firm. And no one here is going to sell you Amway. It's just a way for us to connect with you. So please fill those out. Stand and join us in worship, please.
This is a fairy song.
this day. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for your truly amazing grace that you have bestowed on every one of us. Just to be able to get up this morning and come to church in a free country where we can worship you openly and with all our heart. We love you and we praise your name. Amen.
Thank you. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down.
Hallelujah.
Chasing after this world, heading to see time.
chance to greet those around you, and please, for those of us that have been here regularly, say hi to somebody you don't recognize. Take 47 seconds.
47 seconds.
So what you're seeing over there, I'm kind of seeing back there.
Yes.
It's still going, right?
Yes. Don't forget Press On Ministries every first and third Saturday, 6 o'clock right here. And on the 15th of September, we're having food. Food. In the barbecue. Be there. What do you got to say there?
That's awesome. Will, are you glad you're here?
Yeah.
I certainly am. It's been a long time coming, and it's kind of like drinking out of a fire hose. Got a lot going on. It's an exciting day. Our children are at camp today. They come back tomorrow. So be sure and lift them up. And in fact, let's just stop right now and pray for our kids at camp. Amen. Father, thank you for the opportunity for our kids to go to camp. Thank you for safe travel there. We pray that you keep them strong in the last few hours as they're there, that you keep them safe, that all the sponsors would be wise in decisions they'd make, and that they would connect well with the kids. We pray for the hearts and minds and wills of the kids as they connect with the ministry there, that they would grow. This would be a life-changing experience for them. And as they drive back tomorrow, Father, we pray that you keep them safe on the road. So thank you for the opportunity for our kids to go, and for the love of those who went as sponsors. And so, Father, thank you that we can trust you with that, the rest of children's camp. And we do in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Corrie ten Boom. Anybody ever heard of Corrie ten Boom?
Yes.
Corrie ten Boom was a Dutch watchmaker and a Christian who, with her father and family, during the Nazi Holocaust of World War II, helped hide Christians, helped hide the Jews. And she asked a simple but a powerful question. If you guys could put that on the screen. She asked a simple but a powerful question. Is prayer your steering wheel or your spare tire? As I was praying about, Lord, what do we talk about our first Sunday together as a family? Where do we start? And very, very quickly, it came to me, we start with prayer. Interesting thing is, by the way, from here, going forward, today is a standalone message. We're gonna talk about prayer today. Going forward, starting next Sunday, we're going to begin, I'll be typically preaching in series. We're going to begin a five-part series next Sunday entitled Healthy Church. We're going to be talking about five things to make a healthy church. We'll unpack those one at a time beginning next Sunday. So you don't want to miss that. What's interesting is I listened to sermons that were preached here in preparation for, before I got here. And I just kind of see, what's God been speaking to you, kind of get me orientated. And so I found out that Brother Bill down here in the front was going to be preaching one Sunday. So I pulled up online to listen to his message. Now, because I knew that this was going to be a crazy week, my first week, get moved in and meeting, meet everything. I've been working, I've been thinking through, praying through this message for like 2 or 3 weeks. And so I already had this message kind of on the drawing board. And so when I started listening to Bill's message, he said, we're going to be in Ephesians 6. And I'm thinking to myself, that's interesting. Am I about to hear the message that I'm planning to preach? And so I listened to Bill's message. How many of you are here for that, by the way? If you didn't get it, I'd encourage you to go back and listen to that. Bill did a great job of talking about the fact that we are in a spiritual battle. And he talked about spiritual warfare. He got into the armor, which we'll talk about. I'm like, okay. And you know what? He stopped just short of where we're going. So it's almost like God orchestrated this together. So what you learned from Bill a few weeks ago, we're gonna expand on that. We're going to be referring back to that. So we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 6. Context, Paul is writing to believers in Ephesus. And in chapter 1, he prays this. Ephesians 2, 18 and 19. Chapter 1, Ephesians 2. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you will know what is the hope of his calling. What are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? And what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe? So the big idea in Ephesians is the riches that we have in Christ. Basically two broad categories, chapters 1 through 3, he unpacks the riches that we have in Christ. Chapters 4 through 6, he talks about, with those riches, how does that work out in our life? So the passage that we're looking at is comes in the second half, chapter 6, right at the end of the book. And so just as an example of the things that we have in Christ that we're going to come back and touch on, in chapter 1, verses 13 to 14, he says this: "And when you heard the word, the gospel of your salvation, when you believed in Christ," here it is, "you were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit, who is the down payment of our inheritance until the redemption of God's own possession to the praise of his glory." What's he saying there? When we receive Christ, in other words, when we trust him and receive Christ, what do we receive at the same time?
The Holy Spirit.
We receive the Holy Spirit and we're sealed. So we're going to come back to this, but we have the Holy Spirit as believers. So this morning, let me just read our text. We're going to be in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 18 and 20. And it'll be on the screen. "And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray for me, pray also for me, that whenever I speak, words may be given to me, that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should." Now, if you'll bear with me, I want you to hear the same passage in Eugene Peterson's paraphrase, The Message. He says it this way: "Be prepared. You're up against far more than you can handle on your own." How many of you are dealing something with far more than you can handle on your own? Okay, so we're in a good place. Take all the help you can get, every weapon God has issued, so that when it's all over but the shouting, you'll still be on your feet. Truth, righteousness, peace, faith, salvation are more than words. Learn to apply them. You will need them throughout your life. God's word is an indispensable weapon. In the same way, prayer is essential in this ongoing warfare. Pray hard and long. Pray for your brothers and sisters. Keep your eyes open. Keep each other's spirits up so that no one falls behind or drops out. And don't forget to pray for me. Pray that I'll know what to say and have the courage to say it at the right time. Telling the mystery to one and all, the message that I, jailbird preacher that I am responsible for getting out. So let's unpack Paul's coaching on prayer. Paul, in these verses, these two verses, he's going to talk to us about prayer. What does it look like? And let's look at three powerful points about what prayer should look like. There's notes inside the program, the bulletin, if you received those when you came in, so you can kind of follow along. They'll also be on the screen. But let's talk about these three things. Let's start off with this. He says, pray in the Spirit. Now, remember we just said that when we believe in Christ, we receive Christ, what do? We receive the Holy Spirit. So we have the Holy Spirit. So now he says, pray in the Spirit. So context, well, there's a contrast that we'll see as we go through the book of Ephesians. A contrast, when he says pray in the Spirit, what are we talking about? Well, there's a contrast between in the Spirit and in the flesh. We're in this spiritual battle. Again, as Bill helped us understand, we're in a spiritual battle, Bill?
Yes.
Yes, we are. Our passage today is a part of this instructions on putting on the full armor of God. And he tells us why. Go back to what Bill taught us in Ephesians 6, verse 12. "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the worldly forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness." Where? Where is this taking place? In the heavenly places. Throughout the letter, we see this contrast in Ephesians 2, 1 through 10. There's kind of, I'm just catching the main parts there. Paul says, "And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit, which is now working in the sons of disobedience." That's what you were. "But God, being rich in mercy because of his great love for which he loved us, raised us up with him and seated us" where? "In the heavenly places." That's where this warfare takes place. So what Paul's helping us to understand is there's a war that's taking place that we don't see readily with our eyes. We've got to understand this or we're going to get what? Clobbered. And so What is he? Let's. What is he talking about when he says, "Pray in the Spirit"? Praying in the Spirit is praying under the control of the Holy Spirit that God's will be done. It's having the Holy Spirit guide what we pray. How many of you know we don't even know what to pray? How many of you know that? We don't even know how to pray. Look at Romans, what Paul said in Romans 8:26. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know what we need to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes with us with groanings too deep for words. In the flesh, we're what? We're weak, we're self-centered, we're self-focused. It's all about me. I've got what I want. And we come in. But in the Spirit, we're in touch with God's will. Okay, this is why relationships go south so fast. Relationships go south really fast because when we get in a relationship clash, rather than humbling ourselves and trusting ourselves to the Holy Spirit, what do? We come charging in, demanding that God get the other person to see it our way. You've never done this. But that's a default. That's what we tend to do. Let's also understand that this is not a special form of prayer. Minds might go when we say pray in the Spirit, might go to speaking in tongues. That's not what he's talking about here. He's talking about, because the next thing he's going to say, on all occasions, this is the way we should always pray. Let's look at Jude 20 and 21. But you, beloved, building yourself up in your most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. So what's he saying? He's saying when we pray in the Spirit, we keep ourselves in the love of God. Listen to it in the Living Bible. But you, dear friends, must build your lives ever more strongly upon the foundation of our holy faith, learning to pray in the power and strength of the Holy Spirit. In verse 21, stay always within the boundaries where God's love can reach and bless you. When we operate in the flesh, do you understand that when we're operating in the flesh and not in the Spirit, we get outside the boundaries and we're wondering why God's not blessing us? We need to be operating within his boundaries. When a person seeks the Holy Spirit, it prays in the Holy in the Spirit, they're seeking God's glory and God's will above their own. And what happens to them is secondary. Want some examples? Here's some examples. Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. Remember the story? Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. What's he facing toward the end of his life? He's looking at going to the cross. He prays this: my Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, what? Your will be done. That's praying in the Spirit. That's trusting ourselves to the control of the Spirit and wanting to be in the will of God. Look. And then another one is in Acts 16, 7 through 10. Paul is praying and his team is wanting to go to Bithynia, but being sensitive to the Holy Spirit, I mean, they had these plans. How many of you had some plans and you were so excited about those plans and then all of a sudden the Holy Spirit said, you couldn't go there? This is what happened. They were trying to go to Bithynia and the Spirit of Jesus did not permit them. See, there's so much that we just go charging in and we don't even pay attention where the Holy Spirit. We need to be praying in the Spirit. Paul said, this is a familiar one. Remember Paul's thorn in the flesh? Any of you got a thorn in the flesh? Okay. Don't nudge your person next to you. Don't do that. Paul prayed three times at this thorn in the flesh, and I love that we don't know what it is because it fits everybody. But he was satisfied with the answer that God gave him because God said, no, the thorn's not going away, but my grace is sufficient for you. Here it is, 2 Corinthians 12:9. And he has said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is perfected in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, I will rather boast about my weakness so that the power of Christ might dwell in me. Paul so bad wanted this thing in his life, whatever it was, that's why it can fit for any of us. You have that something in your life that you just wish would go away? When we pray in the Spirit, I often get this picture. It's like, Lord, I got this request. I believe you can do this. I believe that you can do this. One day I wake up and realize, wait a second. My belief is not in God. My belief is in my request. That's a problem. When we pray in the Spirit, we submit ourselves to where He's guiding and directing us. So too often, again, we miss that in prayer. We miss the whole spiritual battle. Now, in context is key. Verse 18, if you go in the original Greek, you know, we've got the verse breaks and the punctuation so much so that we can kind of reference it really well. But this is tied to the verses before it where Paul's talking about the spiritual warfare. And the word with in verse 18 means by means of. The New American Standard says, with all prayer and petition, it's tied to what was before. The spiritual armor, how is it accessed into our life? With, by means of, what? Prayer. The hymn writer George Duffield understood this when he wrote the hymn, Stand Up for Jesus. How many of you remember this old one? Please don't stand, but you might want to sing along with me on this, just so you remember. The third stanza. Stand up for Jesus, stand in His strength alone. The arm of flesh will fail you, ye dare not trust your own. Here we go. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with. That's how you get the armor on. We pray it on. This is how, in this battle, we access what... See, God has given us these tools, these armors, to access His power and His authority in our life. How many of you know you can have something, but it doesn't do you any good because you don't use it? How many of you know this? Okay, so I had a friend, Doug, who does a lot of work, and so... He introduced me to knee pads. You know what I'm talking about? They're hard plastic on the part that covers your knee. Underneath is the jelly stuff. And it's got the Velcro that goes around your knee. And so if you're down on your knees doing something, it protects your knees. I thought, I'm going to get me some of those. So I get me some of those, and I take them out of the packages. And I'm so proud. I got me some knee pads. These knee pads are going to protect my knees. And so I have them hanging in my garage. So I got them hanging in my garage. And what happens if I go to, I don't know, say paint the house and I'm working on the baseboards? I say, you know what, I don't want to scar up my knee pads. And I have them, I'm so glad I have them, but I don't use them. What happens to my knees? Get all torn up. So understand, we have these implements that Bill introduced. We have the spiritual armor. But it can be there, we're going to have it, and we're getting clobbered because we're not using it. Would you put the picture of the, how many of you drive a truck? Pickup truck? Okay. This is not an advertisement, which is interesting. I was Googling to get a picture of this spray-on bed liner. You spray it in your truck, and it protects your truck. What's interesting, and I thought somewhere this is an illustration, when I Googled to get this picture to use as an illustration, guess what pops up all over my computer now? Bed liners in this bed. So anyway, there's an illustration there somewhere. But anyway, the bed liner, you spray it in, and it protects the bed of your truck. Watch this. This spiritual armor, help you remember, we don't spray it on, we pray it on. And we get protected. I love how the Living Bible says, verse 18, first half, God, ask God for anything in line with the Holy Spirit's wishes. Did you catch it?
Yep.
Ask anything in line with the Holy Spirit's wishes. I like how it says it. It's easy for us to slip into a false sense of strength when we know doctrine really well. We know the scripture. We know it really well. We can answer any questions about the Bible. But we begin to trust in our knowledge more than God. And here we go again. We start getting clobbered again. Walking in the Spirit is so key. Are you okay with the goofy illustration? Now, here's a goofy illustration. Babe, can I use you as an illustration? She's like, please don't. No, let's say that Kim's away on a business trip, right? She's away on a business trip, and she writes me love letters telling me her thoughts and that she loves me and everything. And I'm like, oh, wow, this is awesome. So I take these letters, and I treasure these letters. And, you know, I keep them safe. I even memorize the letters. I take some portions of those letters, and I print them out real nice with a nice font, and I put them in a frame. And I even share pieces of those letters with my friends. And then when Kim comes back from her business trip, I'm like, oh, wow, thank you for the letters. And I'm so focused on the letters that I neglect Kim. Does that happen in our relationship with God? Oh, yeah. We can get so tied up in doctrine. Don't hear me wrong. We're going to talk about this next week. Doctrine is key. We need to understand doctrine. We need to have correct doctrine. But if we're neglecting walking in the Spirit, then, you know, we're missing out. I told you that next Sunday we're going to be in a 5-part series. September 16th, we're going to begin a series entitled Transformed, where we're going to be talking about living Spirit-filled life. We're going to unpack over 9 weeks. We're going to look at the fruit of the Spirit, each one of them. What does it mean to have that fruit of the Spirit? What does it mean to have the Spirit, to be walking in the Spirit? So that'll be really cool. Okay, so pray in the Spirit. What's the next thing? Pray on all occasions. One translation says, pray at all times. Luke introduces Jesus' parable of the unrighteous judge this way. He says, now he was telling them a parable to show that at all times they ought to pray and not lose heart. Do you see that on the screen? He says, at all times they ought to pray and what? Not lose heart. Sounds like there's a choice. Either you can do one of two things. You can pray or you can lose heart. I choose prayer. But let's pray. So Paul in Ephesians 4:6, Philippians 4:6, do not be anxious about anything. Instead, in every situation, through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, tell your requests to God. And then in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, rejoice always, pray without ceasing. Give thanks, what? In all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Paul is talking, catch this, Paul is talking about having a heart and mind that's fully open to God at every moment of every day. This is living in an attitude of prayer. This is having a minute by minute exposure of our hearts and minds to God while we experience everything. Why? Because at every moment, at every step of our life, we need to be getting God's perspective on things. How many of you know that every one of us in this room, how many of you know we see things through a filter? Every one of us has a filter, or if you would, a lens, that instructs, it dictates how we perceive that. And I can prove it to you. Have you ever noticed that two people can experience the exact same thing but have totally different responses to it? Yes. Why is that? Because of this principle. We all have a lens. Well, laying this over, pray on all occasions. We need to be open with our hearts, our minds, our wills to the Holy Spirit so that we get God's take on everything we experience. Very practical example that's right here. Paul's in prison when he writes this. And what is his request? He asked a specific request. What was it? That he would pray also for me, that whenever I speak, words may be given to me, that I will fiercely make known the mysteries of the gospel, for which I'm an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it fearlessly. So here's Paul in prison. Now, hopefully you won't find yourself in prison, but you know where you might find yourself? You might find yourself in a very uncomfortable or tragic or very challenging situation, and what do you need? You need God's perspective on it. And so Paul's perspective is, he knows that God's working in and through him, even though he's in prison. And this is huge. By the way, this is a prayer that I would love for you to be praying for me. Lord, help Steve to know what to say, when to say it, how to say it, and to say it boldly without fear. I would love to get those prayers. Now, let's understand some Greek words. In the original Greek, there's two different words for time. One is chronos. Chronos is from which we get the word chronology. It's the passing of time. It's a sequence of time. But there's another word, and it'll be familiar with most of you, kairos. Does that word sound familiar to anybody here? Kairos. Kairos, in contrast to chronological or sequential time, it signifies a proper or opportune time for action. So what's Paul saying? He said, pray at every occasion, every opportunity, because whatever those things that happen in our life, those are opportunities that God wants to work through, and we need to pray through all of them. So, again, remember what Corey Ten Boom asked us? Is prayer our steering wheel, or is it our spare tire? Oh, all we can do is pray. No. Prayer is what we do at the front. Every opportune time. Jesus said, I was in prison and you came to me. So just for fun, to make this real very practical, what are some occasions, some opportunities, some things that might happen in our life that will come to every one of us, and how to respond? Let's look at default actions, and then we'll look at what the scripture says. Okay? So, someone does you wrong. Okay? Someone does you wrong. Typical default action is what? Go tell everybody you know and try to get them on your side. Come on, Pastor, your first Sunday and already stepping on toes? Not good. No, actually, it's okay. Someone does you wrong. The typical default action is go tell everybody, try to get them on your side. What does God's word say? Jesus said, Matthew 5:44, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Guess what happens when you pray for someone who does you wrong? Sets you free. Oftentimes you said, you know what, that person does me wrong. And the reason why we don't want to let it go is because they deserve to be punished. They should be locked up. That was not good. That may be true, but that's not our place. A lot of times, they could care less. It's not bothering them a bit. We're the ones that are all locked up about it. And so, when we pray for enemies, guess what? God can change that person, but He changes us in the process. That's the whole message right there. But someone does wrong. How about another one? You have a big decision to make. Anybody got a big decision to make? You got a big decision to make. What's the default action? Ask everybody you know. Get everybody's input on it. Which Bible says, get wise counsel. Not a problem. But have you prayed about it? Jeremiah 33:3. I love this. Learned this in high school. Call unto me, God said, and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things which you do not know. James 1:5. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should what? Ask God, who gives generously and without finding fault, and it will be given to you. How about if a friend sins? You have a friend that sins. Typical default actions, maybe one of two things. Make sure everybody knows about it. And the spiritual way this is done is, oh, we need to pray for sister so-and-so. Pray for her. She did this and this and this and this. Let everybody know. Or, maybe more heart-wrenching, just write that person off. You know, the Christian army is the only one that shoots its own wounded. You've heard this. When a friend sins, what do? 1 John 5:16. If you see any brother or sister commit a sin that does not lead to death, you should pray and God will give them life. When someone sins, I love that we do Kairos ministry. I believe in the grace of God, and I believe that by God's grace, anybody can change and get a second chance. Praise God. There we are. You're in trouble. Default action. Dig in and try harder. When I was in high school, I'll call him Bob in case he might happen to hear this message. I call him Bob. We're on a band trip, and we went to the water park. You know, they have the big wave pool. Maybe you love the wave pool. Wave pool. Well, Bob didn't know how to swim. So we assured Bob, hold on to the styrofoam board and get out there, and everything will be fine. Just hold on to the board. Well, Bob gets out there, and everything's going fine until all of a sudden the wave hits, and he gets flipped over, and he's scared to death. He's scared he's going to drown. He's got his eyes shut. He's screaming, I'm going to die. And he's got a white-knuckle grip on this foam board. And the hilarious thing is the water was this deep. The water was waist deep. But he was so locked up about it, had his eyes shut, holding on to dear life, and his friends were standing. We tapped him on the shoulder. Bob, open your eyes and stand up. Sometimes when we're in trouble, we get this white-knuckle grip on the situation, and we have more respect for the situation than we do for God. When we need to relax and just stand up. And as Paul says, stand firm. So how about if you're anxious? If you're anxious, typical default, vapor lock or medicate. What does Paul say, Ephesians 4:6? Do not be anxious about anything, but everything in prayer and supplication. With thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. How about if you feel far away from God? Anybody ever feel far away from God? Just feel like God's a million miles away. Default action, try to do good things to get back. Try to do good things to get back. Psalm 145, 18. The Lord is near to all who call on Him, to all who call on Him in truth. David, the famous passage in Psalm 51, David committed the sin with Bathsheba, the adultery. And we read this powerful, heart-wrenching prayer, Psalm 51, familiar passage. Create in me a pure heart, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence. God's feeling a million miles away. Or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Did you know that God is omnipresent? Which means what? Where is He? Everywhere. One day we'll dig into this more, but there's God's presence. He's present everywhere, and there's His manifested presence. When we praise Him, we experience His manifested presence, and that's very key. How about if you're overwhelmed by temptation? Overwhelmed by temptation. Default action. Get in there and fight with some more spiritual disciplines. Get some disciplines. And I'm not saying there's not a place for that, because there is. And particularly men, we talk about that. It's kind of my realm. We could talk about those disciplines that we need to have in place that can help us to deal with temptations. However, Matthew 26:41. Watch and pray that you may not enter temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. So we pray, and the spirit gives us the strength as we press in. Again, when we pray, it access that conduit of God's power and authority into our life. So, big point, when these circumstances, these situations come up, they're kind of like one of the dummy lights on the dashboard of your car. When that light comes, when these things happen, let them be like one of those indicator lights, dummy lights, and they're indicators to do something. What do? We have to fight against those default actions, because that's what we're the natural thing in the flesh to do. But what we need to do is we need to pray in the Spirit on all occasions. So we need to pray in the Spirit on all occasions. And then finally, number three, pray with all kinds of prayers and requests. All kinds of prayers and requests. So there's a couple words to look at. Paul says, when he uses the prayer, prosek, one of the Greek words for prayer, it's a general word for prayer. It's talking about, it's a worship connection with God, and it's used exclusively about related to communicating with God, and the emphasis on worship or devotion. Then there's the word petition, desis. It has its original meaning is to want, to lack, to desire, to long for, to beg. We get the word supplication, petition. One commentator called it the cry of a personal need. So Paul says as we pray, there's general prayers we pray, but we also need to pray specific, about specific things. We see this, it's been called the Lord's Prayer, but really I like to call it the model prayer, which we won't have on the screen. But Jesus taught us to include things like our daily bread. We pray for specific things. Again, in our passage, Paul prays for a specific thing. We talked about he prayed that God would give him the words to say and speak boldness. So that's there. Let's be reminded that these words that Paul is saying, that he's teaching about prayer, are connected to the spiritual armor passage. Okay? So, how many of you pray for your kids? Hope you pray for your kids. Pray for your kids. You pray for your family. We pray for our kids every single day. Kim and I, before we walk out the door, we pray for our kids and all other prayer requests. Here are some specific things, again, because this is in the passage of spiritual, the armor, some specific things, some suggestions based on these pieces of armor. Let's go back to those. So these are examples of things we can pray for our kids, family members, work associates, fellow church members, however that works out. Pray. How about the being girded with the belt of truth? We need to get God's, we need to pray for God's truth on things, don't we? How many of you know there's a difference between facts and truth? Okay, so it could be the fact is my leg hurts. That's a fact. My leg hurts. It could be, I'm building an example here. This is not true, so don't freak out. Oh my gosh, stop everything. My leg hurts. So that's a fact. And because my leg hurts, I'm going to go get me some Advil. And I'm going to take Advil on a regular basis. Because the fact is my leg hurts. But it's only when I go to the doctor and find out the truth is there's a blood clot in this leg. You see, are you making the connection? Oftentimes, we get so focused on facts, we don't understand the truth. What's really going on here? Yes. We're talking with someone, maybe, Bill, I'm sure you run into this a lot in youth ministry, but for any of us, we're talking with our kids or neighbors or work associates, and they're really locked in the grip of fact. Step back spiritually. What's the truth? What's going on here? What's going on underneath all this? We need to pray that the truth would be seen and that they would see the truth. Again, they would have the filter of looking at things through God's eyes, the breastplate of righteousness. How many know that our hearts can get blown up really fast? And so we pray for protection of our hearts, because once the enemy gets a little bit of a foothold, guess what? He could totally wreck the heart. The feet shod with the gospel of peace. What do feet do? They get us where we're going. And when we look at when chaos takes place or whatever challenging situation, we need to pray those we pray for that they would be able to step into those situations experiencing the peace of God through those, that they'll be able to keep moving. And that ties right with the next one, taking up the shield of faith. As we're moving, not only do we need to walk in the peace the Spirit brings, but we also need to, now he says, take up the shield. We need to understand we have this faith. Salvation, everything about salvation is a gift. Even the faith we have, God gave that to us that we put back in him for salvation. We have this faith. And so the prayer needs to be that we act, even if everything, that we step out in faith, even when other things, I don't know if we could do it. No, we need to step out in faith based on the truth that God has given us. Those fiery arrows Bill talked about, those fiery arrows, what's the difference between a flaming arrow and just an arrow? Is the arrow going to take you out? Yeah, an arrow can take you out. What does a flaming arrow do? Yeah, it creates all kinds of, you know, distraction and confusion. That's what Satan wants to do. He wants to get in there and kind of blow everything up. But faith is tied with the gospel of peace. We step out and we step in what we know God's called us to do. The helmet of salvation, oh my goodness. We need to pray for the protection of minds. Our minds. Talk about a battlefield. Paul says, have the mind of Christ. The Greek word repentance is metanoia. What does it mean? To change the mind. If things happen in our mind, everything's created twice. Once in the mind and once in reality, one person said. So we need to pray that their minds would be focused on Christ. And finally, the sword of the Spirit. Great place to wrap it up, right? The sword of the Spirit. The sword of the Spirit, the one offensive weapon. And what is the sword of the Spirit? It's the Word of God. Now, we get together and have Bible studies. Oh, it's so neat how all this fits together. And we can learn all these wonderful things about doctrine, how all these pieces fit together. And that's great. We need to be doing that. Paul reminds us here, we need to understand that God's Word is when we get attacked, that Word, God's Word, is how we defeat the enemy. But we can't use it till we know it. So we need to spend time in His Word. So we pray for those that we love, that God's Word would be so strong in their hearts and minds that they would be victorious in whatever they face. Oh, friends, as we begin our time together, let's make prayer the most important thing we do. It's the beginning of what we do. It undergirds everything we do. Prayer is the deal. A couple of quotes. Oswald Chambers said this. He said, prayer does not fit us for the greater work. Prayer what? Is the greater work. Martin Luther is famous for this, and I love this quote. I have so much to do that I shall spend the first 3 hours in prayer. You ever heard the saying, oh, you know, I'm really busy, I don't have time to pray. I love this, what Martin Luther said. I have so much to do that I shall spend the first 3 hours in prayer. Prayer makes a difference. Did you know that God can change in 5 minutes what you can't change in 5 weeks or 5 years? Let's believe in Him, friends. Are you ready to believe in Him? Dave introduced you to the connection card that's in the chair. Hopefully everybody got one of those. If you didn't get one of those, if you could just raise your hand. Jeff, I think he's got some extra ones. If you didn't get... But I want to encourage everybody to fill that card out. It may be that you don't have anything to add to it other than your name and contact information, but I'd like everybody to fill that out. If you're new, if you're just visiting, there's places on there. There's some ministry that you're interested in, you can check on that. But on the back, that's what I'm getting to, on the back of that card, and these will be available every week, if you have prayer, if you have something you want for me and our staff to be praying about, write that on the back of the card, prayer request. If you have comments, concerns, questions, all that can be done on the back of that card, and I encourage you to do that. This card will be available every week. If you don't have it ready in time for it to go in the offering plate when it comes by, you can put it in the box on your way out the door, so I don't want you to rush through that. Have the opportunity to do that. So we're going to have a time of, let's just pray as we move into a time of a response. Father, thank You for the coaching that we get from Paul about how to pray. That we should pray in the Spirit. Not just rushing in with our demands and this is what we want, this is what we feel like we need, but to pray in the Spirit, submitting ourselves to You, Your work in our life, Your direction in our life, on all occasions, not just in the happy ones, not just in the ones that we want, but all occasions, and then all kinds of prayers. Not just general prayers, but very specific prayers. And Father, continue to teach us how to pray for those that we care for, that they might be strong. And help us to, Father, pray on the spirit of the armor in the Spirit before we ever leave each day. Father, in this time of reflection, Father, as we seek You, I pray that Father, I pray for everyone
that's here today. Father, you know situations that are going on in hearts and minds that I have no idea about.
Father, know that you know what those are. Father, I pray in this time of response that those would be lifted to you right where they are. Or maybe they would come and kneel at the altar. Or come and I pray with you. Father, help us to leave those things at your feet. Father, I pray that we talked about the fact that your Holy Spirit, we need to pray in the Spirit. We can't pray in the Spirit until we put our trust in you and receive you in our mind. Father, we pray if there's anyone here this morning has never come to the understanding that you love them and so much that you died on the cross to deal with the sin that separates them from you. That they would put their trust in you, receive your forgiveness, cross that line of faith, and by doing that, receive your Spirit. Father, if there's anyone here that says never put their trust in you, we pray that today would be the day of salvation. Father, it may be that what's going on in someone's heart, someone's mind this morning, maybe it's something different from even what we talked about today. We know that you can meet that need as well. However you choose to work, Father, we make ourselves available to you in this time. In Jesus' name. And as the praise team sings, we're going to have a time of just response. However God leads you to respond, it might be that you would respond right where you are. It might be that you would come and kneel in front. Maybe you want to come and have him pray with you. Whatever God leads you to do, let's all stand as we have a time of
the cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. Sorrow may come in the darkest night, but the cross has the final word. There's nothing stronger, nothing higher, nothing greater than the name of Jesus. All the honor, all the power, all the glory to the name of Jesus. The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. Evil may put up its strongest fight, but the cross has the final word. There's nothing stronger, nothing higher, nothing greater than the name of Jesus. All the honor, all the power, all the glory to the name of Jesus. The cross has the The cross has the final word. The Savior has come with the morning light. Yes, the cross has the final word.
Amen. Isn't that a great song? The cross has the final word. May that be. Yeah, let's give a word. Back what we said, that we would walk in the Spirit this week. Where the Spirit leads, where the Spirit guides us, we'd recognize situations for the truth of what's really going on there. And that's wonderful. We're gonna worship you. You may be seated. We're gonna worship the Lord through the giving of our tithes and offering. So our ushers will come forward, and we're going to as the offering plate comes by, this is an opportunity to give, but also the connect card, you place that connect card in the plate. I don't want to rush you through that. If you happen to not get through with that card before the offering plate comes by, not to worry, that's what the box by the door is for. You can drop that card in the box. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for all that you've blessed us with. Father, thank you for the opportunity to worship. We've worshiped in song. We've worshiped through getting into your word. And Father, now we worship through the giving of our tithes and offerings. And Father, by giving, we recognize that everything we have came through your hand. And Father, this morning we give with joy and we give with anticipation that we continue to work through us. In Jesus' name.
This morning when we started, I told you how awesome God is and that I would share some of that later in the service. Usually on Mondays after Sunday service, I start praying about what song selections we'll have, and then we discuss them as a band, and we all individually pray about them. And this next song we're going to do, I picked it so we could play it last night at Press On and practice for Sunday, and one of my bandmates said, "I can't stand that song," and I said, "We're doing that song." And no, it was Danny. He's not here. And I said, "That's almost sacrilegious if you don't like Michael W. Smith," but he said, "I don't like that song." So we're going to play this song, and it'll become evident to a big group of people why God put this song on our heart to do. So this is a song God picked, so you got to like it.
Yeah.
Singing, youth, I want you to look around this room and see what you're surrounded by. Keep singing.
This is how I fight my battles.
Look around this church.
This is how I fight my battles.
This is what you're surrounded by.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like this is how I fight my battles.
Amen.
So we're going to fight our battles this week in prayer. Everybody said?
Amen.
Okay, we're going to give you a couple of words of instruction. Something we're going to do. There's a couple of things that I want to let you know that we're going to do that I'm going to ask you to bear with me on. I have a reason for them. Kim and I are wanting to get to know everybody. And so one of the things we're going to do during the lunch, back over in this corner, Bridget, you can start making your way. Oh, is she dead over there? Okay. No. Bridget's going to be back in the corner, and she has our camera. Okay, and on a table, she's going to have sheets of paper and Sharpies. And so just sometime during the lunch, I would like for everybody, if you would go by families, I'd like for everybody to just, you know, go over there and write your name on a sheet of paper and hold it up in front of you.
Mugshot.
Thank you. Mugshot. And she's going to take your picture. And this will help me, and I'm going to create a pick file. And so she'll kind of give you instructions on that. Are you guys okay with this?
Yeah.
Yeah. Everybody say, yes, I'm okay with this. Woo-hoo! Okay, so that's going to take place just kind of during the lunch. Okay, so I wanted to explain that to you. The next thing is, when we get ready, as soon as we're, after we do the next thing I'm going to explain, the way we're going to do lunch is the men and the boys are going to start setting up tables back over here. Everybody say, yay, men and boys! Yeah. The men and the boys are going to start back in the corner setting up tables here. While the men and the boys are setting up tables, what are the women and the children going to do? They're going to get in line, and they're not going to eat all the food. No. They're going to get in line, and they're going to fill their plates so that when they come out of the line, the tables will be set up. Then men, after we get the table set up, then the men will get in line. See how that? And it's going to work like, you won't believe how nice that's going to work. Okay. Now, one more thing. Kim, would you tell me? Okay. What we're going to do is we're going to take a family picture. Once you come to my house, you'll understand this. We're going to take a family picture. Bridget, would you come?
Camera.
Bridget?
Camera's right behind you.
Okay, great. Bridget, Kim and I are going to stand in the middle. We want everybody to kind of move in and get around us. Bridget's going to take a picture for our first Sunday together. Bridget. So we're all going to stand right here. And you guys are all going to kind of speak together.
That's my picture being in there is really a good thing.
Yeah, everybody. This is the first Sunday together.
Thank you. Amen.